Okay, I just switched on the microphone, so can you hear me fine from everywhere? Yes, okay. And please tell me if I don't write big enough, because I know it's a, okay, it's a big, long board, but not very, so I have to be careful about writing very wide. Okay, so the title is Eaton Lenses, Pseudo-Integrable Billiards, and Genericity Along Curves. So let me explain what I'm going to do. I'm going to present today two questions in mathematical physics, one about the systems of Eaton lenses, and one about a special class of pseudo-integrable billiards in ellipses that I will describe in a second. And these are two mathematical physics questions which appear quite different. They're kind of related to mathematical billiards. And it turns out that the proofs of both the solution to these questions rely on the same result, actually on two results. And one, both are results which concern Birkhoff genericity and Ozeledes genericity for certain curves in the space of affine lattices. So it's an application of some homogeneous dynamics, and in one case of some Teich-Muller dynamics, probably I won't have time to explain at the end, to some mathematical physics questions. So the outline, I will start with these two applications. I will explain you the problems and the result. And then I will state a theorem in homogeneous dynamics, which is behind both of them. And hopefully I will explain at least the first theorem, how it follows from the homogeneous dynamics. And I think if you've been to Jens Marklow's course, if the students were here, there are some connections with what he might have taught last year, so last week. Okay, so let me start with the first application. So I'm going to look at mathematical billiard. So let me first say what is a billiard in an ellipse, for example. So I'm going to take an ellipse. And then I'm going to look at billiard trajectories. So I'll change color. So I'm going to look at trajectories of a pointless ball, which when it hits the boundary of this ellipse is reflected so that the angle of incidence is equal to the angle of reflection. So this is how a billiard trajectory bounces inside this elliptical billiard table. So when you hit, you draw the tangent, and then the angle here and here are the same. And actually, there's a nice way to draw these trajectories nicely. So if you find an co-focal ellipse with a larger table, which is, this is my trajectory, sorry, not good, okay. Okay, this is what a computer picture would be nicer. So there is, I'm drawing a red ellipse, which is supposed to be co-focal with the white table. And it turns out that the trajectory which is tangent to this ellipse, billiard trajectory, will stay tangent to this ellipse forever. So this is a good way to draw your billiard trajectory. So I hope the picture is clear. So a trajectory which stays tangent to this co-focal ellipse is actually a billiard trajectory. So the angles with the tangents are always equal before and after. So maybe I'm going to write this. So billiard trajectories in an ellipse stays tangent to a caustic. And I'm going to write it in red, since I draw it in red. And the caustic is going to be a curve. I'm going to call it C lambda. And it's going to belong to the family of co-focal conics. So I can write equations. So x squared over, and that's important. A minus lambda plus y squared b minus lambda is equal to 1, where lambda is in, say, 0a. And here I'm assuming that the ellipse is the conic corresponding to lambda is equal to 0. So x squared over a plus y squared over b is 1, and A is greater than B. So if this is your ellipse, this is the family of co-focal either ellipses or hyperbolas, according to the value of lambda, and your caustic will belong to this family, and this family is parameterized by the parameter lambda. Okay, so we have a parameter lambda that parameterizes the family of caustics. And in this example, the billiard is integrable, and I'm not going to define integrable systems. I guess here there are people who are experts and teach this. So there are enough integral of motions. And in particular, what I want to say that there are some natural invariant sets. So let me call I lambda is going to be the set of trajectories which are the part of the phase space whose trajectories are always tangent to a fixed conic C lambda. So this is invariant set. It's an invariant set which contains trajectories tangent to C lambda, so a fixed caustic. And clearly, trajectories cannot be dense in the whole billiard, but if you restrict to an invariant set in these integrable systems, it turns out that invariant sets are isomorphic. The flow on an invariant set are isomorphic to flow restricted to I lambda. It behaves like the linear flow on a torus. Flow on a genus one surface, on a torus. And hence, in particular, either for certain values of lambda, you have periodic trajectories, or if you don't have periodic trajectories, then your trajectory will be dense in the invariant set and uniformly distributed in the invariant set. Okay? So this is just a classical case. So what I want to look at today is not this well-understood example, but an example of what is called the pseudo-integrable billiard, obtained by adding a barrier to this ellipse. So there is a recent paper which was published by Journal of Modern Dynamics, actually 1 year ago, okay, by Dragovic. I'm not sure how to pronounce the names. And Radnovic. And Dragovic and Radnovic in this paper described a new class of pseudo-integrable billiards. I will say in a second what this means. Integrable billiards. And the example I want to focus on is the following. You take the same elliptical billiard, but you add a barrier. So maybe something like this. So for example, ellipse with a barrier. Okay? So now if I look at the invariant set, I still have invariant sets parameterized by the caustics. But now the trajectory inside will, when it hits the barrier, the trajectory will bounce at the barrier, something like this. Again, with the law of billiards. Okay? So this word pseudo-integrable was actually coined in the 80s by, I think, Michael Berry, who is in Bristol, by the way. Sir Michael Berry, I guess I should say. And he means here the invariant sets. I lambda are not genus one surfaces anymore, but they are higher genus surfaces. Okay? Okay. So you get a linear flow on a higher genus surface, flow on a higher genus surface. And then the natural question would be if our trajectories, billiard trajectories in this invariant set, dense in I lambda or uniformly distributed for typical parameters lambda. And the first remark, of course, there are some first remark maybe in the paper by Dragovic and Radnovic. They show that there exist some exceptional lambdas. So I mean, there exist there exist lambdas for which clearly trajectories are periodic, but there also exist lambdas for which the flow, billiard flow restricted to this invariant set I lambda is, for billiard trajectories are minimal, so dense, but not uniformly distributed. Are dense, but not uniformly distributed. So there are some areas where, some regions where they spend more time than others, not uniformly distributed. And it's natural to conjecture that those would be exceptional. So I measure zero set of lambdas. And the first result that I'm going to call theorem A1, which is our first application of the theorem I'll state later, is indeed the following. So this is joint work. Did I say that at the beginning? What I'm talking about today is joint work with Christoph Franchek, who is in Torun, Poland, and Rongan Shi, was currently at MSRI for last semester. And so let me say, this is joint work with Franček and she and myself. So our first result is that for almost every parameter lambda of parametrizing the family of caustics, the billiard flow on the invariant set is minimal and uniquely ergodic. Well, let me say it's uniquely ergodic. That's the important part. And uniquely ergodic means, in particular, that all bi-infinite trajectories, so all trajectories, for example, unless they hit, for example, the tip of the barrier, for which we prefer not to define the trajectory. So all bi-infinite trajectories are dense and equidistributed. So it's a positive answer to this. Are dense and uniformly distributed with respect to the natural invariant measure for the billiard that I didn't mention, but okay. Okay? Sorry? I lambda is this I cork. It was supposed to be like a cursive I. So absolutely the same. Absolutely, thank you. It's supposed to be an I in the script font. Okay. So is the statement clear? So we have this family of billiards with barriers. We fix a caustic, and we look at these trajectories. We now bounce around the barrier and around this invariant. Sorry? The cut here, it's vertical and in the middle, yes. And actually, maybe I should say for every barrier. So the barrier, for every barrier, the quantifiers are for every length of this barrier. Sorry, for every barrier in the middle, vertical of every length, and almost every caustic. Okay? Okay. So that's the first theorem. So if you have any questions before I move further, yes?
If there is bi-infinite trajectories, do you mean that if you just look at positive trajectories, then maybe some...
No, it's fine also. No, if you have one which is infinite in the future, it's going to be, yes. But almost every trajectory will be bi-infinite, and yeah. It's, yeah. I just want to avoid, for example, that they hit this tip, and then, yeah. Okay, so now I'm ready for the second application. So this is an application to what we call systems of Eaton lenses. So let me start with what is an Eaton lens. So an Eaton lens. So it's a circular lens. Or you can think of it, you can realize it as an optical lens, which acts as a perfect retroreflector. Eaton lens, it was discovered by Eaton in this century, perfect retroreflector. So you basically built a lens with a certain diffraction index, which changes. And it has the property that when a light ray enters your lens, it comes out parallel and in the opposite direction. So if the entering ray is in direction theta, it deflects inside the lenses so that when it comes out, the exiting direction is minus theta. Does it make the... Okay. So let me understand, explain better what happens. Inside this lens, here there is the center. So if you hit the lens with a light ray in a certain direction theta, you can draw the diameter perpendicular to theta. And after being deflected by the lens, here you get a rotation by 180 degrees. So this point is diametrically opposite to that. And your ray goes through this diametrically opposite point in parallel opposite direction. Okay. And again, as I said, these lenses can be realized and are useful. So what I'm going to look at, a periodic configuration of such lenses. And you can see the picture already there. So I'm going to fix a lattice, lambda, in R2, in plane, and a radius, R. And I'm going to look at a lambda periodic array of lenses of radius T, radius R. OK? So this is a picture. So in this picture, in this grid, this yellow grid, is my lattice lambda in the plane. And at each point in my lattice, I placed one of those round Eaton lenses. And you should think of this, I don't know, it's okay, obstacles. And then I'm looking, and this is a periodic, lambda periodic array of lenses of the same radius. And then I'm going to look at the motion of a light ray inside this array. So this is an example. This is a light ray in a certain direction. By the way, this lens has this property, whichever direction you shoot, it will come out opposite and parallel. But here now, if I fix a direction, theta, then your trajectory will move alternatively in direction theta or minus theta. So, and it will do something like this. It will snake around your system and move. Okay? So remark, trajectory. Each trajectory move. Each trajectory move in some plus or minus theta direction. Okay? So I can talk of the direction of a trajectory, because up to plus minus sign, it's well defined. And now the question that you may ask, so first of all, maybe I should say, where does this system come from? So many people have heard maybe that mini course last week by Markloff and Stromberson, and you've heard maybe of the Lorentz gas. It's a billiard with hard balls. So you can have, I don't know if Jens mentioned that, but you can have a variation of the Lorentz gas, which is like a soft billiard. So instead of having a hard ball, you can put a Coulomb potential localized in the ball so that trajectories are deflected by the scatterers. And it turns out that for some special tuned value of this Coulomb potential, you get exactly an Eaton lens. So it's an exceptional case of special case of this Coulomb soft Lorentz gas. And I think it was Jens Markloff, who is my colleague in Bristol, who some day told me, oh, look, this is the case that we cannot treat with Strombergson because we don't have enough hyperbolicity to understand the dynamics of this example. And indeed, it turns out that this system is related to, it's related to a linear flow on an infinite periodic translation surface. So it's actually a flat billiard and not a hyperbolic billiard. And that's why it goes beyond the tools of Strombergson, Markloff. Okay, the natural question in any case in this dynamics is, are typical trajectories dense or not, or is the system ergodic in the infinite measure sense or not? And let's go from the beginning, I think it's okay. So there was a recent work by my co-author, Krzysztof Franczek, together with Martin Schmoll, where they actually discovered that, and if you do numerical stream simulations, you discover this quite quickly, that the system is not at all ergodic and that trajectories are not typically dense. So let me give a definition. Usually what you see is the trapping phenomenon. So let me say a direction theta is trapped if there exists another angle, phi, which depends on theta, such that every trajectory in direction t, so I'm going to, in direction theta, so let me say parallel to theta, is confined to a strip, lie in a strip, which has parallel to phi. So I don't know if I can see it in the trajectory that I drew. I think it's too small. But the picture is that, okay, you have this big array of lenses, and you have, in principle, a lot of space in the plane to move on. But what you can find is that there is some strip in the plane of finite width. So this is a strip, which has direction parallel to some direction phi. And if you shoot a trajectory in direction theta, this trajectory, okay, in my picture, it will bounce around, but it will always belong to this strip. Okay, so each trajectory stays in a finite strip and does not explore. Yes, sure. So for every trajectory, there is a strip of boundary lines which contains the trajectory forever. But all strips are parallel. So the direction does not depend. Sure, if I start here, I will have another strip. But width also, width and direction are independent. Yeah. Okay. The width is related to the infinity norm of a transfer function for a co-boundary. So
yeah,
it's...
Yeah, it's a huh?
Actually, this is a good question. I don't know the answer. I don't think so. But no, I think it. But that's a problem that we didn't analyze. So, yeah. But that just concerned with the existence of these strips for now. And let me say that what Franček and Schmoll discovered is that this trapping behavior is kind of typical for random lattices. So the result by Franček. And Schmoll is that, okay, that you say that you fix a direction, and we can say for simplicity that you look at vertical rays. Then, so for every R, for almost every lattice, almost every here, there is a R measure on the space of lattices. For almost every lattice, or maybe I should have said that when you fix lambda and an R, you always want to assume that there is no overlap. So maybe I should actually say, let me add this here, sorry. I should have said that the couple lambda R that you look at should be admissible in the sense that there are no overlaps. So you don't want to, you want to be able to define these systems. So you want to choose an R so that the balls are disjoint given your lattice. But if you fix R, there is an open set of lattices which are admissible, and there is the R measure on this set, and almost every random lattice in that set will have the property that the vertical trajectory is trapped. Vertical direction is trapped. Okay? So this is a nice result, but as you know, in physics, you don't like maybe random things, because then you ask yourself, well, can I produce an example? And actually, in their paper, they also show a specific example. So they give you some lattice and some direction which is trapped. But nevertheless, their natural quantifier, from my point of view, that I was bothering Franček, asking him about, is what do can we do something for all lambda? And this is indeed the... Sorry? Vertical, nothing is special. So vertical is just you rotate your picture so that you put it vertical. It's just to say the idea that these quantifiers work, fixing a direction and throw your lattice at random. It's just a rotation. Nothing is special. No, it's actually, yeah. Actually, I think Christoph visited Bristol at some point, and he had a discussion with Jens Markloff, and Jens was convincing him that it's nice to do this. But I still don't like the quantifiers, so I was unhappy. And apparently, the referee of the paper by Christoph also asked him, well, what about every lattice? So we started thinking of this question. And okay, so the theorem, the second application, I'm going to call it theorem A2. This is, again, I'm not going to rewrite Christoph, Franček, she, and myself, is that now you look at every, for every R and for every lambda, such that the pair L lambda R is admissible. So whenever you can draw this picture of array, and for almost every direction, so again, it's almost every here, no? Theta is trapped. So again, this is the result for random lattices. And here, instead, it's a result for a fixed lattice. And the result is still true for almost every direction. Okay. So this is the second result. Again, now I think I'll move to the homogeneous dynamics result behind both these applications. So if you have any question on Eaton right now, is it clear, the picture? OK. So now I want to set up some notation. And I think some student told me that they saw last week the space of affine lattices, ASL to R over ASL to Z. So that's the setup where I want to work now. So I will recall the notation for people who aren't here or who don't know already. So let me, I'm going to state now a homogeneous dynamics result. And maybe at the end I'll state also translation surface result. But OK, so setup. And I'll explain the connection, at least with application one. And so the setup is the following. So you look at ASL to R. So this is SL2R, this is a space of 2x2 matrices with determinant 1 and real entries. Semi-direct product with R2. And don't get scared, because I'm going to write in a second explicitly what this is in terms of matrices. So this space lives in SL3R, so lives in the space of 3x3 matrices. And an element here, you can think of it as a pair AC, where A is a matrix in SL2R, and Xc is a vector in R2. And you can embed this in R3 by putting your 2x2 matrix here. So here you have the matrix A, and here you put Xc1 and Xc2, and here 0, 0, and 1. So you can look essentially at the 3x3 matrices, which have a matrix here, a vector here, and as you, the product multiplication on matrices will give you this semi-direct product structure between pairs, okay? And then you can consider a lattice inside ASL2R. And the basic example is take the same matrices where the entries now will be integers. For example, ASL2Z. Okay? And then I want to consider the quotient. So the quotient of ASL2R modulo ASL2Z. And this quotient is the space of affine lattices. Let me say that and explain that in a second. This is, so you might have seen the space of lattices, only modular lattices. You certainly see it, you saw it if you were here last week. This would be the quotient of SL2R modulo SL2Z. When I put this ASL, this becomes affine lattices. So let me draw an example. So affine lattices means a lattice, but which is shifted so that the origin is not at 0, 0, but it's at other point. So you can think of fixing a lattice, lambda. And lambda will be, if you have a pair AXC, you will take as lattice A applied to Z2, to the standard lattice. This is a lattice. And then you look at lambda plus Xi, where Xi is a vector in R2, and you are going to consider Xi as an element in R2 mod lambda. So if you shift by the coset of Xi, then you get a new lattice, which is not centered at the origin, but it's centered, now I think that my axis is here. So it's something like this. It's a shifted lattice, okay? Okay. And there is a dynamical system on this space, which is given by the diagonal flow of the following form. So you can take a matrix, e to the t, e to the minus t, 1. The rest is 0. And this acts, well, I quotient it to the right. So this acts by left multiplication on your space. And this is the diagonal flow, which in this case is also the geodesic flow. Okay, geodesic flow on the space of lattices. Okay, let me say just diagonal flow. Okay? So this is the dynamical system. And maybe here is fine. Maybe it was nice to keep the picture. Let me keep the picture and move to the other side then. Okay, so we have the space of affine lattices. We have a diagonal flow. And this flow is ergodic, if you know what ergodic means. This is a very standard result in homogeneous dynamics. But let me say, if you don't know what is ergodic, let me give you a more precise definition. Let me say that a point in my space X is Birkhoff generic. So Birkhoff here is the Birkhoff ergodic theorem. It's Birkhoff generic if essentially the conclusion of the Birkhoff ergodic theorem holds. So if take any function which is continuous, maybe even compact supported on X, and then look at the ergodic averages. So take your function F and compute it along the orbit of x, at of x, and integrate from 0 to capital T in time. So this is the ergodic average of f along the diagonal flow. And the point apart, the starting point is Virchow generic if this tends as t grows to the integral of f on the space with respect to the natural Haar measure on the space of lattices. So at ergodic, if you want, you can take this as a definition, implies that almost every Haar, almost every Bacchae, mu almost every point is Virchow generic. Okay? Okay, so this is just ergodic theory for the space of lattices. So now I'm going to look at a special curve, a class of curves in the space of lattices, a family of one parameter family of lattices. So if I look at the curve, even if I know that almost every lattice is Virchow generic, the curve is a small set, it's a measure zero set. So I don't know if every point in the almost every point on my curve will be Virchow generic. So the first result that we have is indeed a result about Virchow genericity along curves. From here the title, genericity along curves. And I'm gonna say this now. So theorem. So this is theorem. I'm gonna call it B1, but I'm never sure if I'm gonna state B2. So this is Franček, Shi, and Ulcigrai. And the result is that when I look at some special curve, which have the following form. So I'm going to call them gamma of lambda, and I'm gonna write them in this 3x3 matrix. So I'm going to look at curves, okay, let me take my notes just to make sure, of the following form. 1, s, 0, 1, so this would 1, and then here I put a function, phi of s. These are called sometimes horocycle lifts because they are curves which lifts horocycles. And where phi from 0, 1 to r, say, it's a C2 function, and it's non-degenerate. Non-degenerate means that for every rational line, a curve is non-degenerate if it's not, it doesn't, any positive measure subset is not contained in a rational line. So I'm looking at, okay, let me write. Phi here, it's a curve which is non-degenerate. So if I fix a rational line, the Lebesgue measure of lambda such that lambda, phi of lambda is contained in this line is 0. Okay? So it's a curve which is not flat and is not, the tangent is not contained in any rational line. Okay, so this is a family of curves. You should think as lambda changes. Oh, sorry. I'm confused everybody because I changed parameter. This is meant to be lambda. Okay, sorry. So this is a family of points in my space of affine lattices parameterized by lambda. And as lambda change, I get a family of affine lattices. And I'd like to know that the result is about Virchow genericity along families of this form. Actually, there is a much more general family of curves that can be treated, but I want to state only the simpler result because it's, okay. I don't want to state more sophisticated on the degeneracy condition. So you take any curve, any gamma, such that it has this form where phi is non-degenerate. Then the result is that for almost every lambda, the point gamma lambda on this curve is Virchow generic. So the picture is that you have this curve gamma in the space of lattices, parameterized by lambda. And if you pick at random one point on this curve and flow it under your diagonal flow, it will be equidistributed and Virchow generic, okay? And now maybe a remark. Some people in the audience, I don't know if anybody, some for sure, might have heard of a paper by Elkis and McMullen. It's a paper on gap distributions of fractional parts of square root of n. So Elkis and McMullen look at the problem, which is kind of similar, but in reality not connected. So they have a following result. They look actually at the same type of horocycle lifts. So they have a curve gamma in the space of affine lattices with the same exact assumptions, but they look at a different problem. So they take this curve and they flow it as a curve. They push it by AT. And they prove that AT gamma equidistributes. So if you put some uniform measure on this curve and push it by the diagonal flow, it will spread uniformly. So, and what I want to remark is this is these two problems are not connected. So neither implies the other. So, okay, that was just. By the way, we also have our, so this theorem, B1, as I will try to explain, is behind application 1 and also application 2. But we also have a third application, which is about gap distribution. So we have a different result about gap distribution, which can be gathered by this. And if you are curious, you can ask me at the end, because I don't want to go into that now. Okay. Are you still with me? Okay, so I would like to sketch now why this application, this result gives the application on billiards in ellipses with barriers. And for the second result of Eaton, yes?
The two parameters, lambda 1, lambda 2, it would just be Fubini, right? Because this is the unstable.
Yes, probably. Yes, yes, absolutely. Yeah, this is unstable, you're right. This is like a one curve in a two-dimensional unstable.
Yeah, the problem is just one curve.
Yes, absolutely.
It's not four.
Yeah, no. But, okay. 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 So I want to sketch how theorem B1 implies theorem A1. And it will be brief, but I just want to give you some idea. So, okay, the main point that we start with an ellipse, with a barrier, and we look at these orbits, billiard trajectories in this ellipse, tangent to a given caustic. Okay? So the first step was done in the paper by Dragovic and Radnovic. And it's essentially the main observation to me that comes from our paper. The key point in their paper is that if you know integrable systems, you know that you can change coordinates using the right elliptic integrals, and you can change coordinates, change of coordinates by elliptic integrals. And you can map this, maybe here I'm fixing an invariant set lambda. You can map this invariant set into a polygonal billiard. So you can map your, maybe I should draw also the cofocal. Okay, now it's not a good picture. Okay, you can map this picture into a rectangle, and the barrier becomes again a barrier. And what used to be a billiard trajectory there becomes also a billiard trajectory. Actually, in my picture, it's not exactly a rectangle, but it's a strip. So these two sides are glued, while these other sides are reflect. So here you have a trajectory which does the following. Say, here it's reflected and so on. And the key point, actually, this trajectory is in direction, no matter what caustic you start from, this angle, it's always pi over 4. So this is always 45 degrees slope. Okay, so the first reduction, which is by elliptic change of coordinate, is the invariant flow in the invariant set maps to a flow in a polygonal billiard, in this case, a cylinder with a barrier. But the key point is that, maybe to remark that for every lambda, here the billiard, so let me call this system B lambda. This is the billiard which depends on lambda. For every lambda, the billiard trajectory in B lambda is has theta, which is in the set of pi minus, it has slope plus minus 1. So it's either plus minus pi over 4 or plus minus 3 pi over 4. But the billiard table actually changes with lambda. So you have, as you move caustic here, you have a family of billiards for which the direction is always fixed, but the table changes. So some people may have heard that there's, my background is from Teichmuller dynamics and the study of rational billiards in polygons. And there is a celebrated theorem by Kerckhoff, Mason, and Smiley from the 80s, where they show that if you fix a table For almost every angle, the billiard flow, if you fix a table with rational angles, in particular, for example, this table, and you change the angle, for almost every direction, the billiard will be uniquely ergodic and trajectories will be densely uniformly distributed. So the key challenge here is that I'm not fixing the table and I'm not changing the direction. As the natural parameter in the elliptic system, as the caustic change, the table is changing. So I have a one parameter family of billiard tables with a fixed direction. And this is like a curve in the space of billiards, okay? And now I want to know that the typical billiard in this family in that direction has uniformly distributed trajectories. And this is exactly, maybe there is one more step that you can do. You can, and again, if you were students who were here last week, when you have a billiard, you can unfold it, which means you can take, in this case, four copies of your original billiard table, one per direction. I don't want to explain this now. But in this case, you can take four copies of this thing. And what you get is that your billiard trajectory in these four copies is straightened to a linear trajectory. So here, the direction is fixed to be pi over 4. And now you reduce yourself to what is called, this is going to be when you glue these two copies according to natural identification. In this case, you glue this with that. And in the slit, in this barrier, you want to glue this ion. This side of the barrier with that side of the other barrier. And the other side of this barrier, you want to glue it with that barrier. I want to claim that you get a surface, and a surface of genus 2. And you can see it because each of these two rectangles glue into a torus. And these barriers, you should think of them as slits in the torus. So you cut open a slit in the torus. And then you glue these slits, and this will form a genus 2 surface. So OK, moral of the story. You change coordinates, you get the billiard, you unfold your billiard, and you get a surface of genus 2 with the linear flow on it. So this, basically, each invariant set is a linear flow on this genus 2 surface. That's how you see that also invariant sets are higher dimensional surfaces. And now this surface is actually of a special form. This surface is actually, this is a flat surface, which is actually a double cover of a torus, which is a double cover of a torus with a slit. Maybe I'll draw it just like this. It's a double cover. There are two tori, each with a slit. And each of these two tori is in a space of affine lattices. So you can think of each torus as a lattice and each slit as a vector. So moral of the story, and I think I'm running out of time, but I would like to still state one theorem B2 without explanation. So let me be quick now. So I have, as I change the caustic, I have a family of billiards. And as I change, and as I unfold this billiard, I have a family of surfaces. So theorem B1 implies that for almost every lambda, S lambda is Birkhoff generic. And actually here, I'm going to, which is where I'm going to lie, for the Teich-Muller flow. So this diagonal flow of the space of affine lattices lift to the Teich-Muller flow on the space of translation surfaces. That probably you don't know what it is, but in which case, I apologize. But this result, I claim it's enough by some well-known result in Teich-Muller dynamics, by Mesur's criterion for ergodicity. This implies what we want, that for almost every lambda, I lambda, the invariant set has dense has dense trajectories, dense uniformly distributed trajectories. It has uniquely ergodic flow. Maybe let me write it. Has a uniquely ergodic flow on it. Okay. Okay, so it was brief, but hopefully you get the sense of why this Birkhoff genericity comes into play. And maybe I just want to state another genericity result, which together with this one enters in the Eaton picture. So I conclude with the statement of theorem two, and it's also going to be more for experts than. So the second genericity result, which is used only in application two, we know who the authors now. So it's the following. So you look at this time, you look at the family of curves. Let me just write it like this. It's a family, it's a curve in this space of surfaces of genus 2, where S lambda here are actually double covers. It's a little bit more general, but in this special case, I want to just say it's double covers of a flat of torus with a slit. So I'm looking at a special family of flat surfaces, each of which is composed by two copies of a torus with a slit, glued together with a slit. And again, I'm a little bit vague here. And look at the curve of this genus 2 surfaces, which project to a curve as in theorem 1. So I have a curve of surfaces of genus 2, but I want that as I move my curve, the torus with the marked point with the slit moves in the space of affine lattices as one of these horocycle lifts that I described in theorem B1. And then, this is again where I'm going to lie because jolly experts will. So in the space of flat surfaces, there is what is called Koncievich-Zoric cocycle. There is a linear cocycle, which consists of taking product of matrices along the Tuck-Muller flow. And okay, I just want to state it because I cannot define this. So what we are proving, again, there is lambda, the parameter is lambda. For almost every lambda, this surface S lambda, I want to say it's Ozeledet's generic. So Ozeledet's multiplicative ergodic theorem guarantees the existence of Lyapunov exponents for this linear cocycle. So for almost every lambda, in this family, we have Ozeledet's genericity for the Koncievich-Zoric cocycle. I don't know if probably, maybe Anton Zoric, if you were here, gave a talk. Did Anton Zoric mention the Koncievich-Zoric cocycle? Any student who was here? No? Sweet. Yes. Okay. So again, this is another result about genericity, not Birkhoff genericity, but Ozeledet's genericity for the product of matrices. Yes. And this is what we need to show the existence of these bands, because these bands are related to eigendirection of certain Lyapunov exponents, and they exist exactly when your surface is Birkhoff, Ozeledet's generic. Thanks a lot.